first week in a while, like,
so
a full week.
Yeah.
It's
hard.
So we can go in there, but it's very cold out there, so we'll never see that.
This weather is not helping, I don't know. The weather's good today? No.
Isn't it really long?
Yeah, I don't know why.
So it's not fun. It's not working. Is it working? Is there like a volume? What is going on? Supposedly working. I don't know if it's, I'm supplying anything. Fine. Alright. So, time to start, right? Before I actually start, a few announcements. I'm pretty sure the reading material is for like the next three lessons is already up and loaded. So to be aware of that. So we wanted to let you know about the ENU workshop. That's going to happen next week. ENU, for those of you who don't know, is the SX Neuroimaging Unit. It's where the magnet is, the MRI is, and where all of the researchers in the LSEC and the Hebrew University conduct their MRI studies. And they can't really see her for some reason, but they're having a two-day workshop. This speaker from a gentleman who works from NYU. I'm not sure where this is from, but it's going to be about encoding and decoding. It's going to be probably pretty methodological. If you have any interest in learning these things more for your own sake, you're very welcome to register. Free. Probably still open, not sure. And it's going to be in a new building. probably. Most chances are something in a new building. I actually forgot to say, for those of you who don't remember, my name is Shai. I'm the team. And I'm in a big mental lab. And the goal of these kind of lab, not really a lab, is part of the class is to kind of experiment with data analysis of the data, to kind of feel these concepts that you're being taught with your own hands. And you can have 2 weeks, so there are like three parts, right? There's the EEG, MRI, and functional MRI, and then fMRI, and after each segment there's going to be this type of experiment, which is going to include basically me kind of briefly reiterating concepts that will be important, and then starting just to work on the assignments together. And you're going to have 2 weeks, I think, to be more than enough. And if you need an extension, let me know in advance, not like an hour before submission time. More than that, questions, if you have any questions, those only answer questions, which will show them on the forum. Unless for extreme example of cases, but that's the case. And it's going to take me time to answer. And that's not because I'm busy, but because I want to encourage you to answer your peers and to create a discussion. Obviously, if somebody answers something that is wrong, I will step in, and you know. But questions will be turned into discussions on the forum, I hope so. And that means you should not wait till the last minute to do it, because I will not answer in time, and then you will be wrong. All right, so a short reiteration about what you've been taught that might be relevant. And this is not, I took slides from Tal, which took them from Alon previously, and they tried to make them more relevant to us. So the assignment is basically going to be kind of running parts of a pipeline of an of the analysis from the EEG. So I'm going to reiterate what is the experiment of an EEG. So we measure the voltage. The voltage is measured between two points. So we always have reference points. And this is then transferred, digital conversion. This is basically sampling, right? The voltage is continuous, but we don't have an infinite amount of data. We don't have the ability to take all data points. We have some sampling rates. Evan mentioned the Nyquist theorem about what is a sufficient sampling rate for measuring certain frequencies in the data. And this is then turned on to a computer, which we can binarize and use in an hour. And, but of course, we have many, many electrodes or data points along the frame. And the goal, most of the time, but not always, is to eventually for each kind of electrode that is placed upon the brain, have some electrical signal that corresponds to some event. It could be perception, action, or something else. But of course, the data is recorded for a very long period of time. Sometimes you can have data for 40 minutes or an hour, depends on the experiment. Edwin's experiment, actually, where he measured, I think he talked about it, the gamma, not broadband gamma, I think it was, I don't remember which gamma, some kind of gamma that he measures as a prolonged response to a stimulus. So usually people see, oh, whenever you see faces, the initial response is whatever, see whatever. So you find something that is prolonged, that is sustained activity. And in his experiment, I think people were recorded for an hour and a half at a time. Something. Has any of you ever done EEG experiments? Did you like it? Yeah? All right. So each channel, we call each electrode a channel, and it records some of the signals everywhere. We record on the scalp, which basically is a weighted sum of all of the signals and structures in the brain. And therefore any change will be recorded simultaneously. Alright, so one of the things that we're gonna, basically most of what we do when we do the pre-processing of the data is try to increase the FNL. The SNR is the signal-to-noise ratio, for those of you who don't know. It's something that is important not only in EEG, but in many human methods. We have an MRI, we have a large volume that has a lot of different signals in it. The same here, we have one channel that has a lot of sources for a signal, and therefore many times the signal-to-noise ratio is very low and you want to improve it. So it's basically the amplitude of the power of the signal divided by the power of the noise, or the amplitude of the ratio squared. The signal, the definition of what is a signal and what is noise may vary depending on your data, your experiment. An eye blink usually will, for example, be considered noise, but not necessarily always. So a signal would just be what we're interested in, the event that we're interested in. And just as to understand how bad it can get, event relay potentials, which is I think Evan mentioned quite often, are usually at the order of a couple of microvolts, whereas an eye blink is at the order of hundreds of microvolts. So the SNR, because it's squared, is 1 to 10 to the 4, so it's very, very low. So how can we increase the SNR? Any ideas? What will you do if you want to have a better? Okay, so the first thing we can do, you're talking about analysis, but there are things that we can do even earlier. So we can tell a subject, try not to blink. That's when I did the experiment, they were like, don't blink during the trial. And it became very strange. Or we can make sure a lot of the noise sometimes comes because the electrodes are not placed very well. So make the conduction between the electrode and the scalp better. So there are already things we can do before the analysis. But it's true that at the analysis stage, we want to emphasize characteristics of the signal. So either in the frequency domain, some frequency, like low frequencies, things that change very slowly. Many times, the noiser is stronger than the signal. There are not a lot of signals in that that change, not a lot of neural activity happens at a very low time scale, but there is a lot of kind of noise variation that will change very slowly. You see like slow drift in data. So you want to attenuate those kind of frequencies. We can also maybe remove, maybe, you know, some electrodes will be more sensitive to length than others, so we can just choose the right electrode. If you were interested in a response to a visual stimulus, we're going to look at a posterior, an occipital electrode, for example. And at the time domain, we can average, like you said, or filter different frequencies. We can average across individual subjects, which I actually don't know many people who do that. We can also lose signal. We can lose variance between individuals. And we can reject different specific frequency bands that we know are that are noise. Yeah, it's impossible to completely separate noise and signal, but most of what we do in the processing will be trying to improve this in art. All right. So, like I said, we have a lot of electrodes. Usually, we have many subjects, but we're going to focus on just one subject. One common kind of experiment design would be to compare between two different things. So the data you're going to work on today is from it's the actual data from an actual experiment. And what they did, if I'm not mistaken, is present faces, two subjects, and they wanted to see if there's a different response between familiar faces, unfamiliar faces, and scrambled faces. So scrambled faces would have the image would have the same kind of characteristics in terms of intensity and color and frequencies, but it's not going to be a face. What you do is just present whatever, let's say, familiar and unfamiliar faces, and then you can segment your data based time locked to the stimuli presentation, and then, like you said, we're going to average. Do you have some intuition as to why averaging would increase the SNR? And the signal is not. Right, exactly. So, basically, in every channel, the recording is the sum of the signal and the noise. So if we repeat the, we do n trials, we repeat the stimuli n times, then, and we assume that the neural response, so the signal would be the same every time, but the noise distributes randomly, what would happen is that our average, recording instead of signal? Their average recording would be, the SNR would be n times stronger. And if you need a proof of exactly the mathematics, it's just very simple statistical properties of noise that distributes randomly around zero. So that's a very efficient way, and it's done in probably all experiments. Just to get a sense of what it looks like, so what you see here are two separate trials. This is the raw data. The individual eight trials, and then the average of, just not an average, but the first trial, average of two trials, average of three trials, etc. And anybody see something that stands out in individual trials versus average data? If I just showed you these two trials, what would you say is the most prominent feature of the neural response or of the electrical response? The downward? You wouldn't say this one? I would say this one probably, because maybe I expect. But you're right to say that after averaging a lot of data, this thing cancels out, and we are left with this downward response that is revealed to be signal and not noise, or most likely. And so you see that there's quite a lot of variance, quite a lot of differences between a single trial and an average trial, and that's just eight trials. We usually do dozens. Alright, so just briefly, I want to say that not all noise sources distribute randomly, and there are some artifacts that we are familiar with, and there are other ways of dealing with. So you see here isaccades that create very sharp changes in certain electrodes. See, I think EMG is a muscle movement, if I'm not mistaken. This is the heart movement, which is very kind of regular. What is that? I'm not sure. Oh, skin potentials, which you see this kind of lower frequency change, and of course the alpha waves, which, do you remember when we see them? All right. So what can we do with artifacts? We can either reject a segmented artifact or correct them. What do you mean reject? If I see a trial and I see that there is a recognized, I look at the data and I look and I see that there is some heart movement that interrupts the data, I can either just say, okay, I'm not going to use the trial at all, or I'm going to try to correct it. What is the disadvantage of just rejecting the data?
Information.
Right, you can lose information. Another thing that happens is you can actually miss, if you say set some threshold, you might miss some of the artifacts. And like, oh, you see a trial and you don't recognize that there's an artifact there, and then you actually do the like a false negative. Correcting artifacts is, you can do it either in the time domain or the frequency domain, and just kind of subtract. I see this very characteristic, slow frequency change, and I say, okay, let's just subtract all of this frequency from the data. So I'm not rejecting any time segment, but I'm just removing some frequency from the data. That would be, for example, artifact correction. And it kind of has the same disadvantage. You can either undercorrect or overcorrect, thus either losing actual signal or gaining. And before you actually start working on the data, I want to show you one kind of cool artifact called the corneal retinal dipole. And it's caused by the fact that the eye is actually a dipole. So it has a potential. And therefore, if I have electrodes on either side and the dipole changes its location, or we might see a change in voltage. So usually there are several electrodes that are just meant to kind of find that artifact, find that movement. And this is, I'm not sure what the entire acronym stands for, but this is a superorbital and inferior orbital electrodes, and they are reference to this reference point, which is really bad. And when the eye changes, the dipole reverses its potential, and you see an opposite effect on the voltage. And if it moves the other way, then we'll see the opposite reaction. And it's very, even I will show you now, when you look at the data, it's very big. How about going? Should I turn off the other as well, or can you see? See? Alright. So, this blue, light blue line is an inferior orbital electrode. This one is superior. We also have a left and right that will help us to track what kind of eye movement. Left and right eye movement. So, and the other electrodes are the ones that are located in touch here. Alright, so if we're looking at this time segment, we see the entire kind of voltage for a lot of electrodes. Would you say that this was an actual event that happened or an artifact?
Well,
depends
on what you were trying to look at.
Visual perception. Attention. Actual neural response. Neural response. No. So what was it? Right. Do you think it was an upward or downward or left or right? Alright. So if you only looked at the top four electrodes, would you be able to say it with as much certainty? Take that. Yes? So many times it really helps to look at the entire data, because if you see something that's kind of that I only see in electrodes that are supposed to be sensitive to eye movements, but I don't see them in electrodes that are closer to neural origin, I have more confidence that it was not a neural origin event, but artifact. And vice versa, if I see something that's everywhere, I might say, oh wait, maybe muscle. I need to smooth. Yes.
If you would see the same amplitudes in the C19, 21, and 23,
many things. I would have to, first of all, many clients now also have eye tracking to make sure, because it's very helpful, but it's not clear. C19 is closer, right? I might be suspicious, but I wouldn't know. Alright, event or artifact. It's a bit harder to see. Right, exactly. Here. I think it's enough for dumb movement. But you can see that it's not like 100% clear, right? But these very, very sharp increases that are strongest in the orbital surface would be a very good hint. Another something that is very easy to see, like I said about muscle movements, is see very, very strong disturbance in almost all of those. That's how muscle movements work. Alright. So, like I said, the experiment we're going to start after this slide is just some experimenting with analysis of EEG data, right? Almost raw EEG data. You're not going to do all of the things that people usually do, but you can do some of them, and I encourage you to kind of test more things if you want to kind of get a feel of the data. I only uploaded. Hold on a second. Alright, so usually you start with re-referencing, and there are a lot of ways to reference the electrodes. There are either one electrode here, or you can, there's something called double banana, so each electrode is referenced to another one, and not all to the same electrode, then you might, the thing is, if the, for example, the reference electrode has a lot of noise, this noise will be in all of the electrodes afterwards. So there are it kind of helps highlight different aspects of the data when you re-reference the electrodes. Next step is usually to filter out very low frequencies, like the one you saw with skin conduction. They're usually more noise than signal. Line noise, are you all familiar with that? I think Evan mentioned it. It's the noise that comes from just the electricity around us, basically. It's very, very strong. I think in the States it's 50 hertz, 60 hertz, or maybe the other way around. So don't believe any effect that you see in the paper that is around that frequency. Correct for artifacts or reject artifacts. And then you segment by trials, average, to find your piece, if that's what you're looking for, if not, that's what we're going to look for. And many times there's baseline collection, so you want our kind of baseline to be around zero. Happens, and then some additional filtering, inspecting, and doing statistics, and maybe special analysis, or source localization, and more advanced analysis that you probably won't. Right, and finally, usually people conducting EEG experiments, not always, but usually, they want to compare two groups or two trials, so they to get an even stronger signal. What you would do is average all of your subjects. You don't do it at the raw data level, of course, but you might average your ERPs so you get in the end. Alright, so everybody has their laptop, everybody has MATLAB, everybody downloaded the signal. So what I was going to say and stop in the middle is that I think in the directory I gave you there is only one subject data. There is actually freely available data for 20 subjects, they will allow to do more. They will allow more interesting, maybe, and statistics. It was initially a bonus question. It's currently not there, but if any of you are just curious about it, maybe you're considering going to an EEG lab and want to get a better feel of the data, just tell me and I'll put the entire data set on the slide. So you basically what you're supposed to do now is start the assignment and see if you have any questions and deal with the data. Or if you have any questions now.
should have put it there yesterday. כן? אני, כן. היה לך אכפת לארבע? אחות. כתוב על לאו סבמישן, טוב, אני אשנה את זה. כתוב על פרש רגע? יש?
Gracias. De lo de elementos que coja, ¿no?
No.
Lo pago con él.
Digo, más pasado. Shaniqata, when the assignment says make sure to add everything to your path, there's an actual function called add path. Add path, I'll write it down. Add path gen path, and then all of the functions will be, you can just call them and will know them. So gen path means it's going to be with all of the subdirectories.
Gracias.
I wrote a matlab and I call it mine, right? But if the directory that mine and is not in recognized by matlab, I will call it matlab.
Well, the question how many students do you have for this, or especially access,
sampling rate is defined is how many samples per frame. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Gracias. Y I
potential.
Gracias.
y la prima se bonita. אתם יודעים מה עכשיו אני צריכה לעשות? לשטוף את הכלי שלי. אני צריכה לשאיר אותו פה נראה לי. אני פה לא ככה כל יום.
Thank you.
ben yürüyüş tekniği de ben